So good afternoon. Thank you all for being here today. First, I'd like to invite you to sign up on our mailing list, which is over on the librarian's desk. We also have posters with this year's program, so be sure and pick one up. If you're on Facebook, log on and become our friends. Also, if you've missed an event, all of our previous readings are videotaped and housed, posted online within 3 weeks at our website, lunchpoems.berkeley.edu. Next week, come back and join us for our sister program, a Story Hour, hosts Joyce Carol Oates on Valentine's Day, 5 p.m., right here. So do come back for that. And join us next month as we make our foray into language poetry with Professor Lynn Hajinian here at Berkeley in the English Department. And now please welcome the director of the Lunch Poems program, Robert Haas, who will introduce this afternoon's guest, Kathy Park Hong.
Thanks, Giovanni. You know, though these seats are reserved, it would probably be more fun for Kathy if she was looking out at people, not a blank. Anybody feel like coming up and sitting up here? Can I convince a few people to come on and fill in? Yay, thank you very much. Yeah, sure. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Kathy Park Hong, who, as you'll see, is really something. She's an amazing poet, amazingly inventive poet, and her new book, which was, we thought we had timed this so that we could be celebrating the new book, and it's not arrived, but if you have not read her, there are two books on the table for you to catch up with. The new book is called Engine Empire, just out, and the two other books are, the first one is called Translating Mo Um, which was published in 2002, and then Dance Dance Revolution in 2007, and now in 2013, Engine Empire. Kathy was born in Los Angeles, has a BA from Oberlin and MFA from the Iowa Writers' Workshop. I was inclined to say, if you grew up with incredible antennae, bilingual in late 20th century LA, what kind of poetry would you produce? You're going to find out. Though you wouldn't think it until you heard it, she seems completely to come out of a world in the making that she's partly in the business of making. Translating Mo Um meditates partly at the beginning, invoking the spirit of dictée and of Teresa Chong, which gave a radical and innovative turn to Asian American writing, to American writing at that moment. And Kathy set out from the beginning thinking very hard about living inside language, living among many cultures, how you make poems that could possibly refract all this cultural possibility, and then went on after 5 years, still quite young. Robert Frost, after all, didn't publish his first book until he's 40. You're not nearly there yet, right? Still quite young, wrote Dance Dance Revolution, which it basically invents a creole in which to write a new kind of poetry. It's quite amazing book. It's, as this book, Engine Empire, is, it's furious, nervy in the sense of too open to everything to bear, witty, dystopian, has a very dark view of things, and weirdly jubilant in its sheer inventiveness. This book, my wife last night said, okay, stop, I got the idea, because she had work to do, and I kept laughing and reading her parts of it. This book has three narrative sections. The first section is a Western. It's Gertrude Stein meets Sergio Leone halfway through Michael Ondaatje's Billy the Kid, and it's written in the form of ballads. The second is a group of sonnet-like dystopian poems about an imaginary Chinese boomtown in the 21st century. You're going to give the flavor of some of these, so I don't have to. And the third is takes place in this kind of future. I hail an aero cab, turn up my personalized surround soundtrack, wistful to anthemic, to voice recognition, a song strains after a longed for sweet spot of identification. Oh, parable diced three ways, I want to share my thoughts with you and form. Anyway, it's sci-fi in a world of virtual reality. And all three of them involve inventing the language that we're hearing around us and living in. She's a wonder. Please welcome Kathy Park Hong.
Thank you, Bob. That was really, I was really honored by that introduction, and I'm really honored to be here at Berkeley, and I've been here a few times, and it's always really lovely to be back. especially since I'm a Cali girl. I guess I'll just read Engine Empire straight through. And if anyone's actually read the book, you know, feel free to throw out requests. I usually start from the Western section, but I think I'll try to change it up and read from the Shangdu section. I've been tempted to just really scramble it up and just read just a mix of poems where I'm just like, okay, here's present day China, here's Western, here's future, and then, but it just, it confuses me, so I'm gonna keep to one section at a time. Bob did a beautiful job of introducing the three sections. They're almost like their own worlds. I really tried to kind of create their own worlds with their own idiom, with their own set of characters. And these speculative cities or landscapes are kind of almost like these stage sets, but they're also characters in them of themselves. So I hope you get a sense of the landscape. So this section is from Chengdu, my artful boomtown. Obad. I long for a harmine morning to lift me from my hiss-hurled life. But my hell-whelmed county of harsh, scruffed crops is marooned. My plow, a beached whale's browbone on morose miles of moor. Heft, heft, I cry to my ox, but no hint of green wort. Just midges to torment my ox. You intone, forgo, lament, willingly forfeit the eye-eye. So I slaughter my ox. So hi. I am ready in my plaid-wound puff-puff golf hat, ready to be whelmed by a pest or a cacophony of crickets chirruping in their cage balls, juddering slam of hammering jack, humming susurrations of catamarans, aerosol striations of welder's firecrack. Then a caracas of fist cracks, after workers slurp off their goggled specks to a bassooning foghorn hooning, so spooning lovers know when to return to their dawn shift, tuning cymbals for toy baboons who clap, clap, hail the industrial age, hail. Market forces are brighter than the sun. My grandam, my Turks, frozen in time, Harun Kaduri Sassoon with your bolts of canary silk, sheared and sold down Shangdu's river, alongside a wedding of gamblers betting in a vintage sampan. Barges of creaky banquet hall, spit out your prawn tail in this ramekin. Shots of Crown Royale for all. Dear natty vessel of chemical dye, dear floating factory of cleaning supplies, let me buy you out. My wire hanger is mannered like the virgin neck of a Parmigianino nude. My lint roller can defer a Pomeranian dog. Shangdu, my artful boomtown, I will smudge out your horizon line with my thumb. I will stuff you cheek to jowl and pipette you with petrol, chasing out urchins nibbling on beetle kebabs. Foreigners, do nip from that blue label in our train, which is faster than the Shinkansen, powered by your merry laughs. Ho, 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 ha, 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 ho, ho, ho. Chow, bring me my napkin. My thumb is smudged with a horizon. I'm going to read, this is a longer series. It's called Adventures in Chengdu, and I modeled it off of Marco Polo's travels. And these are just sort of a group of prose poems about the city. And, you know, some of it comes straight from my head, but a lot of it is also stolen. Like there's this one image, this artist, Waleed Rod, who I reference in one of the prose poems. So I'll just read them. Parts of it, just little parts. Adventures in Chengdu. Of lucky high-rise apartment 88. The contractors were in a hurry to catch up with the rest of the world. So they rushed off before they finished building high-rise 88. So here is my apartment without its last wall, gaping out to a panoramic view of Chengdu's river. Across the river, all the white-tiled factories hum anxiously. This hum of 2,000 factories can inspire or drive you mad. Yesterday, a drunk man and a suicide used 88's unencumbered views to fall to their deaths. And now there are ads for new roommates. I am one of the few women who live alone in this building. My last roommate married as quickly as she moved in with me. I see her in the neighborhood, pregnant and gloating, with men who fetch her footstools. Of the millennial promenade along the river, vendors line the promenade to serve passersby. They sell pinwheels, pancakes, and roast meats of all kinds, even sticks of prickly little seahorses. One female vendor keeps peeled apples under her armpit until they are saturated with her scent, and then she sells them so customers can luxuriate in both the scent of fruit and her ripeness. Along the promenade, the rabble is enraptured by the new tower across the river, but the vendors grumble of slow business. Officials installed cameras behind the vendors' umbrella fringes to catch conspirators. Today, there is no drama, so the vendors gossip. It is true that the fried prawn vendor tilted his surveillance camera so it caught nothing but the sun. Officials executed him after they watched the useless footage of a sun bobbing up and down for 100 days. Why did he do such a stupid thing? He was a saboteur, said one. We should all destroy the cameras. Everyone knows about them and it takes away business, said a third. It was for personal reasons. He was stupid in love and his lover walked out on him for, and the vendors stopped short for the cameras were recording. Of the old colonial Dutch quarters. When I imagine this city, it is not the city that I want, but the city that I fear. But I too have an obsession. He is one of the painters who works in the Rembrandt factory. He paints 5 Rembrandt self-portrait paintings a day, which I hear are sold to rich townhouses and hotels in a place called Florida. He is renowned as the fastest painter in Chengdu, and he has completed 10,000 Rembrandt self-portraits. In the mornings, I walk past him when he is on his smoke break. Today, I catch him sniffing his hand. I'll read one more from this series, just because I saw the crane right outside of the world's largest multi-level parking garage. When officials ignored their strike, the crane operators decided to be aggressive. They worked all night. The next morning, train carriages, buses, limousines, bicycles, boats, and even helicopters swung lazily in the wind, magnetized by cranes. "Negotiate," they cried, "and we will free your vehicles." Finally, officials promised to bargain, but when meeting day approached, the army rushed into the bargaining room and all the operators conveniently disappeared. Until Chengdu finds a new generation of qualified crane operators, no one knows how to work the cranes and release the vehicles. The magnetized vehicles sway in the breeze, rust in the rain. One driver was drunkenly passed out when they lifted his taxi up into the night. He has lost his voice, calling out to the shuddering city. Okay, I'm going rewinding back and reading from Ballad of Our Jim. There's definitely a little Billy the Kid in there, and there's also a little bit of Medea in here too. But there's a longer narrative sequence, but I'm not gonna read that. I'll just read a couple sound poems. These are lipograms, which use one vowel only. Ballad and O. Can you hear me? I don't know how close I should get to the microphone. No, good. I'm good? Okay. Ballad and O. Oh, Boomtown's got lots of sorder. Odd horrors of throwdowns. Bold cowboys lock horns. Forlorn hobos plot to rob pots of gold. Loco mobs drool for blood, howl or hoot for cottonwood blooms. Throng to hood crooks to strong wood posts. So don't confront hot bloods. Don't show off, go to blows or rows. Don't sob for gold lost to trollops. Don't drown sorrows on shots of grog. Work morn to moon. Know how to comb bottom pools, spot dots of gold, to spoon pots of gold, vow to do good. Ballad in A. A Kansan plays cards, calls Marshall a crawdad. That barb lands that rascal a slap. That Kansan jackass scats, camps back at Kaba Yada Ranch. Hangs cat axe in camp hat. Kansan's nag mad. Rants. Can't bass, can't bacchanal and garland a lass. Can't at last brack and crack law's balls. Kansan's cantata rang at that Ramada ranch. Manana, Kansan snarls, I'll have an armada and thwart law's brawn. Slam law a damn mass warpath. Marshall's a marksman, maps Kansan's track, calm as a shaman, sharp as a hawk, says that dastard Kansan's hat and gnaws fat back. At dawn, Marshall stalks that ranch, packs a gat and blasts Kansan's ass. Kansan gasps, blasts back, a flag flaps, half staff. All right. That's it for the Western. That's just a little short, Western short commercial. So I'm going to read some poems from the last section of The World Cloud. And it's sci-fi. I don't know actually how far-fetched it is. I imagine this is where the internet is going, like, maybe like 10 years from now, or maybe even 5 years from now, or next year. But I was thinking of, I mean, a lot of like the Western is definitely like sort of set around California. This book is very much like a California book. And the World Cloud, I was sort of thinking about, you know, of course it's boom towns are kind of the conceit. And I was thinking about Silicon Valley, which is not far from here. So I'll just read some poems from the World Cloud. You know, obvious pun on word cloud. And there's the only thing I'll say about it is that a lot of what kind of ties these poems together is this device called the smart snow. Engines within the throne. We once worked as clerks, scanning mothballed pages into the clouds. All memories outsourced, except the fuzzy childhood bits, when I was an undersized girl with a tick. They numbed me with Botox. I was a skin suit of dumb expression, just fingerprints over my shamed. All I wanted was snow, to snuff the sun blades to shadow spokes, muffle the drum of freeways, erase the old realism. But this smart snow erases nothing, seeps everywhere. The search engine is inside us. The world is our display. And now every industry has dumped whole cubicles, desktops, fax machines into developing worlds where they stack them as walls against. What disputed territory, we asked the old spy who drank with Russians to gather information the old-fashioned way. Now we have snow sensors, so you can go spelunking in anyone's mind. Let me borrow your child thoughts. It's benign surveillance. I could burrow inside, find a cave pool with rock-colored flounder, and find you half-transparent with depression. Ready-made. I tint the street view, a forgiving dove, since nothing fades to twilight oblivion. So zoom in until my eyeballs need moisturizing. The sitting room is quiet, sprayed with air freshener, the flavor of aged card catalog. Glass shells full of tool tell-alls have transcended into the data air, sealed into capsules you can skim while eating a nuked pot pie. Even alone, you're self-conscious of eating alone. So you try to look busy, dialing the help desk, chatting with a timed Indian accent until the line goes dead. Though nothing ever goes dead. Smart snow has reached total density, drifting even inside the hospice, so you hear the gray-eyed pulse of comas, private as a cargo of stones being dragged across the Arctic, the orphaned fugitive voice whispering, enough, leave me. In a company retreat, cuffed in the legs, partners bumbling toward a finishing line, teamwork so harmonious, the booming trade of information exists without our paid labor. What to do with all this leisure? I blink at my orange trees, spangled with captions, landscapes overlaid with golden apps and speculation, nudging hope like the sham time machinist who returns from the future, convincing everyone with his doctored snapshot of restored prosperity and a sea full of whales, huge as ocean liners, singing the call note of our relieved tears. Who's who? You wake up from a nap. Your mouth feels like a cheap acrylic sweater. You blink online and 3D images hopscotch around you. A telenovela actress hides under your lampshade. You switch to voice activation. Good afternoon, sings the voice of Gregory Peck. You look out your window across the street. Faded mattresses sag against a chain-link fence. The mattress seller sits on a crate, clipping his fingernails. You think of inviting him in. You do a scan. Gregory Peck booms, Dwayne Healy, 28, convicted felon of petty larceny. You don't know what to do, so you pet your ceramic cat. What? You ask. What? You want to go out? Well, you can't. You hear a chime. It is your former employer informing you that they cannot release your husband's password due to the privacy policy. It is their 98th auto reply. You bite your hand. You check in on your husband. After your husband went on roam, you received one message from him. I am by a pond and a coyote is eating a frog. It is amazing. You decide to go outside. You walk to the public park. There is a track where people run while watching whatever they're watching. You sit on an oversized bench. You think of your old townhouse with the oatmeal sofa before you and your husband downgraded to this neighborhood. The sofa made you happy. You decide you need to keep up appearances. You need to clip your husband's nails. They are getting long. A strangled yip escapes from you and a jogger stares at you. You see a palm tree and it is carved up with little penis drawings. You make a sound like tut tut. You enhance the park. You fill in the balding grass and rub the offensive drawings from the tree. You add coconuts. You feel your insides are being squeezed out through a tiny hole the size of a mosquito bite. You hear children laughing as they rush out of a bus, and it sounds far away and watery, like how it used to in the movies when the light was halo-y and it was slow motion and the actor was having a terrible flashback. But you're not having a flashback. Underneath the sound of children laughing, you hear users chatting over each other, which all blurs into a warring shadow of insects. And the one that sounds like a hornet is your husband, telling you to put his stuff in storage or sell it to pay off bills or leave. Why don't you goddamn leave? You sit on the bench until the sky turns pink. When your former employer let you go, they said, you are now free to pursue what you want to pursue. So here you are. The Golden State. Here you are deep inside the marrow of song, a spirit shape tucked in my ear before snow, streams, an old-time town, a general store selling cornmeal, and use dentures. What time zone is this? Home of sad marvels. Pluck my memory out. I am just immigrant enough to feel shame for my overseas kin who live inside gaming, and still their warriors are listless, brooding. You cannot speak her brimmed mind. She went hysterically blind. So they implanted an ocularis, and she said, I see light sharpening to contours, a field, marigolds, golden poppies. I see their names, but why do I smell smoke in the engine? The way memory will just hit, I unvalve the escape hatch, a gentle hiss, breathing in a remote dark planet, suck in, come back. Okay. So that's it for Engine Empire. I'm just going to read a few short poems, three short poems. These are new poems, and they're very much work in progress, and like really, really work in progress. But I've been... I've been interested in the abject and the racialized body. And I've also been watching a lot of stand-up comedy and stealing the language, the stand-up. But these poems aren't funny. I mean, So lower your expectations. Maybe they're funny. No, they're not funny. But, you know, they'll probably be something completely different. But I thought I would read something new. Train, Pig Island. I'm that man. I feel like that man, a truculent fat man, a geezer who leaves his gun in the toilet. Bullies pantsed me again. I'm that pamby little man, my penis flapping between my shirt tails. I'm daddy. I use a stun gun to freeze a man, and I occupy his limp rolls of man. Freeze, said the pig, so I spread my cheeks, lift my sack. Frisk me, I'm a man, ta-da. I'm colognes. The flavor is dirty forest, autumn curds, eucalyptus rubber. I'll assassinate your ardor with my larval white bum. I'm an erratic man, a ruby tom-tom. Hey man, is your kidney murder full of cum? My O-face will intervene. It's a sob, quite pulmonic. Get that toad off the screen. I'm mooning your dreams. Young adult. Old man tucked it between his legs, and we rubbed bellies. The clear heel is a new whore uniform. Forecast. Big box receipts. Children in tankinis jiggling cats. A girl pogos. Anus on my face. Stained milk carpet, hot tub with boat motor. On the laptop, left open, a thumbnail of penetration. This is the last one. it's a little rhymey. And it's a little bit rappy, but I'm not going to attempt it. It's my only sort of superhero poem. Inside the house. This is the last one. I'm no frail eel. No damsel steel. My costume's a bathrobe, secure as hazmat. One look at me, I'm addictive as trans fat. You can't touch my towel rack. My bat caves is Needle Park, but it's been converted to luxury condos, so I'm gonna sing you my vendetta rondos, my hustlings to get Ovidian. Zapping, all them white asses, Sri Lankan tan to black Papua New Guinean. Smoke me some superpower gungeon, ain't nothing like loose Lipton. Then I blast developers to the ghettos of Trenton. So quill it, or I'll shoot you a bindi, bleeding between your periwinkle twinklers. Make bankers squat like untouchable tinklers. My last attack razzed a Coke plutocrat, and he turned to Mohammed Hassad. He tried to rush out of airport Halifax, but customs held him back. Mistook him for a wanted Yemen foe. Pistol whipped him when he made a row. He was a no-show at Chevron, Texaco. 'Cause shit, now he's in Guantanamo. So I'm your Conradian nightmare. Do a little jiggy in that black face. But after the show, no way you're gonna get your fare back. You're still black. Thank you.
Wow, how exciting. So now I know you guys are on fire to buy books. We have them available at the table here in the back, thanks to the campus bookstore. And also, one of the two titles is deeply discounted, so be inspired. Okay. Thank you all for coming, and hope to see you next month.